How microservices communicate? Pretty straightforward and simple, na? Let's take an example of online shopping portal where everything is smashed in a single monolithic application. So there is no other way. There is only one network call from client to server. The user is requesting for something, server is processing that, whatever time it is taking and responding to the client. So pretty straightforward, right? But nowadays it is not the case. We have things something like this one, where everything is divided, every business functionality is divided into its own service. To achieve something, to get that business functionality, we need a network call. So let's take an example of an online shopping portal where we have this thing, product, cart, order, payment gateway. We need some notification analytics, fraud detection also, and recommendation also there. So user, when it is requesting, sending the request to the UI, it is going to the API gateway. Then it is going, so basically here this place also will be some kind of front API gateway to protect the front end itself from the outside world, right? And this front end server itself calling the back end services via an API gateway. So these there are lots of communication, like you see network communication is happening here for specific feature that user is requesting. The call is going to a different microservice, and that microservice, based on its orchestrator and based on the feature that user is requesting, it is calling other services here. So let's say first you are requesting or coming to the myshop.com, it needs to load the dashboard. So product call will be there. You liked some product, you need to add that to the cart. So that another call will be to the cart service, then it will go to the order, then you decided to do the final payment, so that will go to the payment service there. The supporting services will also be there, like notification, analytics, fraud, recommendation. So product, cart, order, payment, these kind of services are there which needs to be happen to complete the request, right? So that means to complete the request that user is requesting, these communication must happen: product, cart, order, payment. But notification, analytics, fraud, recommendation, they can happen on the back end. So they does not need to be they must not add the latency on the main request. They can add, but they will make the call costly, and that will hamper the user behavior, like user experience on our side. So that we do not want to do. So we are seeing here, like, so the complexity in the communication, that at every point we should think that whether we have to make the call and wait for the response or not. So there are two things happening here. First, when one call is going, one service is calling to other service, I have to wait for the response from there. Another case is I can just publish that it is happening, and I don't have to wait for the response to be processed by the other system. So there are two things happening here. So one, we are calling synchronous communication, and another one we are calling asynchronous. Synchronous means we have to wait for the response. Asynchronous means we don't have to wait for the response. The synchronous communication itself can be achieved by these all mechanisms, like REST, GraphQL, RPC, and so on. These four topics are in itself big topic, like you can say it's implementation wise, like how to set up a synchronous communication. So that demo and other calls, you can see some of that. REST we can see on the channel itself. GraphQL, RPC, other methods are there where one service can call other services to establish the communication. So GraphQL is an advanced version of REST. So if we go deep into that, we'll make this video very lengthy, so I don't want to go deep into that one. So this video is about to just establish the thing that why these communications are needed and what are the factors that affect this one. Another one is the like asynchronous. So when we have message queues that we talked about, we don't have to wait for the response. Then message queues implementation can be done by the Kafka, RabbitMQ, ActiveMQ are there. This way, these two wide category, like broader category, happens in the same like microservices communication. So that's what we like when we go deep into this implementation, our communication falls one of these two categories, synchronous or asynchronous. So in interview, if you face this question, so there are two broader categories only. Synchronous, asynchronous, and you can then define whatever you have used, like REST, GraphQL, RPC, and in asynchronous, whatever you have used, ActiveMQ, RabbitMQ, or Kafka. Coming to the next one, when this one service is calling other service, product is calling cart, my shop is calling the API gateway, and this product service is calling the notification analytics service, there is some sort of rule established by which it has to call. That was what we call the protocol. Let's see those protocols here, communication protocols. So HTTP, we all know about it, just couple of word about it, like hypertext transfer protocol. It is the most common protocol used for communication between microservices over a network. So it can be HTTP. That means then you have client and server, the request is going and it is coming, it is just happening on the plain text, no security on the network, but mostly it happens on the secure network. So that is what we call HTTPS. The next one is the gRPC. It is an advanced version of when we have requirement of latency, a lot of improvement efficient latency we need, then we use this RPC. It is a modern high performance open source framework for building remote processor call APIs. It uses protocol buffers as the data format for serialization and deserialization. So in its implementation, it uses the mechanism to send the request and to receive the response and process that in such a way that it improves latency a lot if we compare it with the HTTP. AMQP is another thing. So that is like we are coming into asynchronous communication here. So advanced messaging queuing protocol is the full form of this one. It is an open standard application layer protocol for message oriented middlewares. It supports variety of messaging patterns like including pub sub, point to point, and request reply. These are the things that it supports. MQTT, when we have IoT devices nowadays, there is lots of IoT devices like smartwatch, cars, fridges, washing machines, everything is there. That is becoming smart. How they are becoming smart? Because whatever is happening with them, they are sending an event to the server and server is analyzing, and again as per the analysis it is responding to the user that what action needs to be taken. So the IoT application, it is being used there. So message queuing telemetry transport is a lightweight open standard protocol for machine-to-machine communication. WebSockets is yet wonderful protocol that enables real-time bi-directional. So whatever we have seen, it is a one-directional only. Like you send the request and you have to wait for the response from that. So like client has to send the request to the server and then wait for the response. But in the WebSocket, server can also send the data to the client without its request. It is commonly used for real-time applications such as chat application and online gaming. So it is if I talk about like nowadays, it is pretty old. I have like personally I also have not used this SOAP. So whatever applications we was having in our organization, they are moved to the REST, like representational state transfers. So this is, but it is good to know that it is one of the way, it is one of the protocol that can happen when we are talking about the communication among microservices. Coming to the data exchange format, what is this? So we have this client, we have this server. So when client had sent the request, so let's say there is a user creation request that is happening. So it needs to send its ID, name, address, password, and lots of details to the server. So what format it should send to the server, that server can understand that format. It can't be random, right? It has to be some formatting, in some format that server can understand and process that request accordingly. So there are different data exchange format that are available out there. We are going to list some of that. JSON is a lightweight data interchange format that is easy for humans to read and write and for machines to parse and generate. It is widely used for web APIs and has become the de facto standard for the data exchange over the internet. If you see its example, so you can search on this channel itself. I have created a couple of videos around JSON also, where you can see how to create a JSON, how to process the JSON. By default, in Spring Boot, if you're using Java and Spring Boot, so it has become the default request and response format there. Next is the XML. So before JSON, XML was the most popular way for the data exchange format. It is a markup language that is widely used for data exchange over the internet. But if we compare it with the JSON, it is a pretty heavy. It allows developer to define their own tags, which make it highly flexible and extendable. XML is widely used for data exchange in the industry, such as finance, healthcare, and transport. CSV, it is a comma separated. So whatever data we are sending, they're just separated by the comma. So it is pretty straightforward, like when we have something directly from the database to exchange and in Excel format. So it becomes very, very handy to go that CSV format. Next is the protocol buffers. Protocol buffer, it is a binary format developed by Google for efficient data exchange over the internet. It is designed to be fast, small, and extensible, and is widely used in high performance distributed system. So if you're using the RPC, gRPC is the gRPC is one version of the RPC itself that Google has developed. So protocol buffer is used there. So you see, it is designed to be like very small. It is in a binary format, so machine to machine communication happens very, very effectively and efficiently. That is why latency becomes very low. Avro is another format that is a binary format that is used for the data serialization, and it is designed for efficient data exchange over the internet. It supports schema evolution, which makes it highly flexible and extensible. Thrift is yet another format similar to Avro. It is a cross-language data exchange format that is used for efficient serialization. So if you see, Avro and Thrift are used when we have event-driven architecture mostly. So that's pretty much about the communications, like when we have microservices communication itself and how many things do we need to take into account. Now let's cover some of the questions that we are covering in this series, like after looking into the brief description and see the questions and see how many we can answer that one.